Very good afternoon to everyone. So we have had an interesting lineup of sessions today, starting with infrastructure, infection control, going green, somewhere in between hospital management software. And finally, we come down to the bottom line, what matters most? The money matters, right? The cost of setting up a new hospital is daunting enough. What with the cost of land being what it is. Now, we have this instance where in Mumbai, for instance, a plot sold for almost 45 crores an acre. You translate it and it translates into something like 10,000 rupees a square foot. Now, how on earth are you going to make a hospital which is viable with that kind of land cost alone, right? And then there's a need. Then there's a need to comply with norms. And also the pressure of keeping up with the Joneses. We have a lot of hospitals which have been around for long, and there are new hospitals which are coming up, and we need to keep up with them in terms of the infrastructure. As a result, hospitals today have as much of a focus on hospitality as it does on medical care. Both have become virtually equally important. Whether it merits being that or not is another subject of discussion. Also, unlike residential and commercial buildings, the structures are designed with a higher safety factor of 1.5. The engineering is more complex. All of these add up to a very high cost of setting up a hospital in terms of infrastructure. On the other hand, we have this very strong impetus to contain costs now. We had this news circulating that one of the states has imposed a kind of proposed capping of tariffs for private hospitals. We do not know how that's going to unfold. But this impetus to contain cost will also come from insurers, the payers, who are going to dictate times in dictate the terms in times to come that, this is the maximum we are going to allow you. It already is in place and it's going to get only more intense. If you look at metros, we had this discussion on metros and non-metros earlier in the day. We tend to get away with higher tariffs in metros at places. Smaller towns, perhaps not as much. They have this advantage of a lower cost of establishment to an extent, set off by the fact that you cannot charge as much as you do in a larger hospital. Plus, the fact that you have to attract and retain clinical skill sets is not very different in a small town as compared to a large town. So that only adds to the challenge of making a profit profitable hospital in a smaller town. So in many ways, the healthcare industry is at crossroads. How do you manage your finances for healthcare business, both in terms of capex and opex? So let's get on panel resources who have been very adept at understanding this industry, who have been in the industry for long to help us get insights. So let me introduce you. We have on board today Dr. Rajiv Badankar. He's currently the CEO of Bhatia Hospital, but in the past has been in senior leadership roles in Kohinoor Hospital.
Fortis.
And aside of being a medical doctor, he's also been a management expert, an academician. So may I bring on a request on the dais, Dr. Rajiv Badankar. We have coming up next Dr. Mahesh Padwal. He's a medical doctor again and has done a diploma in clinical research and regulatory affairs. He's been Vokhat earlier and currently is heading Ashoka Institute of Medical Sciences and Research Center at Nashik. May I welcome Dr. Padwal on the dais. And then we have Mr. Amit Sharma. With extensive experience in finance, consulting, and entrepreneurship, he's worked in the US and India in private equity and venture capital with Warburg Pincus, Impact Investment Partners, established a pharmaceutical logistics business. I mean, he's done the works when it comes to financing in healthcare, and he's the guy we're going to draw upon to understand, how we're going to get capital infusion into our hospital projects. Amit, can we have you on, Dias? So my first question, which perhaps is pertinent and on minds of all the audience here, is open to all the panel members. We'll start with Amit. What is your opinion on various options available for funding capex of a project? Which one would you prefer and why?
Right, so the two traditional approaches to funding, it's basically a binary variable. One is debt and one is equity. Typically, your cost of capital in debt is lower in the sense that, you know, unfortunately, here in India, we've gone through a period where you have above 15% sort of interest rates on debt, which makes it a little bit unaffordable. You know, that being said, it is, you know, what it is. It costs about that much. When it comes to equity and when it comes to private equity, what's actually happened is because of a lack of priority orientation of the hospital sector and, you know, affordance of low interest rates, et cetera, we have seen a lot of the industry go towards private equity because of the value addition, et cetera, that they see that it brings. But it comes at a much higher cost, at about 25% or so on an annual basis. And that's typically their return expectation over about 4 years, after which they're going to actually exit. So that's a very expensive option to actually go for. Now, for CapEx and for setting up a new facility, there's a couple of variables, I think, that are very important. Number one is, do you have land? Typically, that's a very, very important concern. You know, if you don't have land and you're renting it, then at what rate are you renting it? Now, your ability to get debt typically is very contingent upon your ability to put up some collateral. If not to put up some collateral, then at least have some sort of a going concern asset that you're able to say it's going to have a stream of cash flow that I can effectively offset this cost of debt on. You know, typically, you know, for promoters who are looking to basically start off the ground without operations, I would definitely suggest them to actually go for debt. And when it comes to private funding, which is secured, sort of private equity-oriented sort of funding, you know, it's, I hate to kind of burst the bubble of most people, but that's a very kind of small segment of the actual industry. And that typically is for assets that are sort of hospitals that have multiple assets, meaning you have at least 2 to 3 hospitals, at least 400 to 500 beds. Maybe perhaps a little later on in the session, I'll take you through the evolution of how the industry has evolved in that multi-specialty, bulge bracket, moving towards single specialty, the exit cycle around that, et cetera. But debt funding typically is very, very important. You know, of course, from HOSMAC that we used to do a lot of techno-economic validations of projects where effectively we need to explain to a bank that this particular promoter can actually pay off this particular stream of debt that he's actually asking for. And interest payments are really important, and they actually take away from your revenues very significantly. So what your operating cash flow is going to be is very important in terms of your ability to service debt. That is typically the best option in terms of starting off. If you have collateral to put up against it, it's fantastic. If you don't, you'll have to think creatively and perhaps go for unsecured loans, which typically involves friend and family networks, et cetera. For startups, right, I would say you should definitely go for that. For hospital businesses, you might bankrupt your family asking them for, you know, 4, 5, 6 crores or something, unless you have some, you know, diamond merchant backache or something effectively that's anchoring your family's ability to pay. But these are the two options, and I would effectively say off the bat, you should think about debt initially.
So the point you're making, Amit, is that despite interest rates being what they are, and despite it seeming that, you know, equity should be a cheaper option, actually it's a more expensive proposition to go for equity funding.
Absolutely. And, you know, institutionally, what's happened, Sameer, if I just may another 1 or 2 minutes, is that, you know, banks themselves are now starting to learn how to actually look at the hospital sector because it's gone through a series of cases. In fact, you know, hundreds of cases where their non-performing asset ratio has gone really through the roof. And effectively, this is because they're not able to model out that, can these guys actually pay me back? They're taking very aggressive financial models and saying that, you know, we're going to be breaking even within a year and this is going to happen. That actually typically doesn't. And what's set in place, which some of you may or may not be familiar with, is a corporate debt restructuring, which actual banks put you through. And they effectively say that, look, if you default on your you know, interest payments for a particular period, they'll put a moratorium on that interest payment, and they'll say that your term loan, we will reissue that as a working capital loan, and then we'll issue you a new term loan, right? So then you get some breathing room. Now you get strike one, you get strike two, strike three, you're out, right? So the third time that happens, they're effectively going to take over your asset. Now it's a chicken and egg situation because no bank actually wants to take over your asset because they can't operate hospitals. So it becomes a very, very messy situation. And now we've got, you know, very, you know, several, probably 400 to 500 hospital projects in India that are just at that sort of question mark stage. And then they get on the block and they get sold. It's not good for anyone. Yeah.
Dr. Bhavankar, you've been associated with projects, a few of which were looking to expand, a few which were, you know, in the initial concept stage, and, you know, you took that forward. In your experience, you know, did they go in for debt as a major source of funding, Was that the easier option?
Well, in my current assignment, it's a very old hospital, so nothing much to add on this front. But in my earlier assignments, yes. In fact, India's first green hospital.
Correct. That's the one I was referring to.
Yeah. So we had gone. In fact, what he said was, I've gone through all this. In fact, I made a presentation to the bank because we were, in fact, that was the only thing we had taken. And then when we couldn't, I'm actually, when McKinsey's and all these guys, they may come and make presentations, healthcare is booming. I'm actually talking the ground reality.
Correct.
Healthcare is booming and 15% CAGR, and it's like the IT industry in the 1990s, and it's going to go up and all. And we are all happy, but the ground reality is not that. Ground reality is something different. People, I don't know if they have, how many people are working in corporate hospitals, but if we have taken debt and the entrepreneurs are, you are the head of the hospital, and if you don't, they don't understand healthcare. First of all, non-healthcare players are coming into it, and they think that, oh, it's so hunky-dory, healthcare is booming, so they should start making, they should break even in 6 months, 10 months, a year. They don't realize, Dr. Gyani is he's probably agreeing with me. They don't realize that it's not that simple. Healthcare is a industry where there are so many variables. There's so many variables. Now this, I'm talking about this hospital, India's first green hospital in Mumbai. Now its location was such, it was somewhere they actually took over the Premier Padmini factory where Premier Padmini was made earlier, and they put up a hospital there. Now how do you expect people to start coming? They have to literally search with a searchlight. Where is the hospital? So there are so many variables. So when we don't start breaking even, now mota mota they say that EBITDA break even is 3 years and PAT break even is 8 to 10 years and all. But if you ask me, 3 years, I worked in 2, 3, 4 corporates, but I have not seen that happen so easily or so fast. And then what happens is these guys, bankers come to you and they knock your doors. What is happening? And again, you make a nice presentation to them and they don't understand the healthcare industry, and there you are. So then the same old story. And at the end of the day, our KRAs, and either it's goodbye from their side or goodbye from your side. I'm putting the ground reality. So if there are non-healthcare players and they want to invest, I'll request them, please have lot of patience. Lot of patients.
Dr. Padwal, what do you have?
Yes, what Dr. Bhavdankar and Amit have said is a fact. What is the scenario what we are seeing. But since I come from Tier 2 city, the picture over there is little different.
Mm-hmm.
Over there, we cannot think of equity. So there we run everything on basically capital investments. And we start with that. To take the more financial help, we call upon the banks. And in some cases, I have seen, I was with those institutes, what sir has said, that then they cannot give the interest back, and then even the basic funds are not returned, and a day comes where there is a kind of a bankruptcy. So like what sir said rightly, we must know how far we can reach, and then we should take a jump. So to do that, basically in small cities or tier 2 towns, we must have the strong capital. And then, to help it, we can think of the banks or the...
So Dr. Padwal just made a point that, you know, in a smaller town, you can't think of equity. My question to Amit is equity at all an option, if it is, for, you know, what caliber or what size of hospitals?
Right. You're talking about private equity?
Correct.
So there's kind of a distinction. I mean, equity per se just means your own money and capital that you're putting in, right? So typically the ratio that you look at, whether it's tier one or tier two, is 2-to-1 debt to equity ratio, right? Now, when it comes to raising private funding, I'll just talk about kind of 2-3 cycles that it's effectively gone through. You know, we have a shortfall of about $1 billion in investment that's required for this particular sector. I mean, everybody, including banks and private equity, probably are not going to be able to fill that for a while, right? That being said, what's happened with opportunistic private equity investors, it started off with this. Let's find the guys who are going to become the corporate hospital sort of leaders of tomorrow, right? So they picked up Narayan Rudelia, they picked up Fortis, they picked up, you know, Apollo and these guys, popped in $100 million, et cetera, right? Now, the whole story at that point in time is that these guys are going to go through the most aggressive wave of mergers and acquisitions, and they're going to pick up pretty much everybody. So as these guys started moving into their year four, year five, all these other players started coming up, Max and everyone, and they're like, and, you know, that was actually one of my deals at Warburg. And we said, let's bump into these guys because tomorrow Apollo can buy them out, right? That didn't actually end up happening, right? Then, you know, what started happening is that there was some exit activity that happened on those bulge bracket hospitals. Then the smaller sort of hospital set started building up and seeing some exits also. And now most recently, there's a concept of single specialty hospitals, nephrology, dental, ophthal, you know, maternal, you know, all of these basic themes, right? Renal. And, you know, the whole idea is that, look, you have a much more controllable cost structure if you're solely put around one particular specialty. Your capex is also lower. You can kind of increase efficiencies, et cetera. However, you know, this is typically somewhere where the scaling is started to be seen on the lower capex areas, which is dental, maternal, and ophtha. But what's yet to kind of prove itself out is a meaningful exit cycle. So what's happened is, let's say, Healthcare Global in oncology is one example. They got flipped around four or five different funds, right? And now they're at a, you know, particular stage where they have to pay off those five investors, right, on 25, 25, 25% each. So I'm not so sure what the promoters end up having at the end of the day. But this whole exit activity on single specialty is something that hasn't been as prolific as it has on multi-specialty. So who is going to get private equity funding today in the hospital market? I hate to burst your bubble. If you do not have 500 beds and at least three hospitals, you shouldn't even waste your energy trying to look for it. Because these investors are basically looking for defensible cash flow, your ability to replicate, and the fact that you have two to three facilities on which they can use the annuity of the stream of income of your others to de-risk themselves to go and fund new capex.
So
right?
Notwithstanding how profitable your particular model is, unless you are scalable and you are in a position to replicate your you know, setup, P is not going to look at you.
Absolutely. And see, the reason is we all know that, you know, there's maybe effectively, and Dr. Gyani might have a different number on this, but technically it's 9 lakh doctors in India, probably effectively 6.5 lakh doctors. Everyone's competing for them. So that's a big component to actually being able to scale. And the second piece is you know, you're one particular location where you are, let's say you're in Nagpur, right? And you have a fantastic practice in a particular specialty. It's not very, you know, possible that if you set up another one in that particular specialty, you're not going to eat from your business there. And now the moment you go to another market, it becomes even that much more difficult to staff and to operate.
So I have a different, can I?
Please.
There's a different model which we tried and actually we were successful. That entrepreneur will bring his part of the equity, and what he does is he goes into the market and he taps doctors who are maybe at the mid-level or slightly at the higher level, but not big stars. And then get four or five guys, tell them to invest, and then their specialties they will look after. So two things happen. One is the entrepreneur will look after the administrative aspects of the business, rather the business part of business, and the clinical guys, the doctors who have invested, they will bring in the footfalls. And what happens is, there is obvious loyalty because they can't run away, their equity is there. So then we don't have to run after, you know, get more business, you know, that is out.
That's symbiotic relationship.
Exactly. And then these hospitals, they grow. And you need not have, I mean, people have a concept that in my hospital, everything should happen. That's the older concept. Now you just take high ticket items, the big ticket items, and you take these guys who are sort of, you know, not heroes, but you're going to make them heroes. Have their equity, and these models I think are the right models for tier 2, and in fact even for metros, why not? Even for metros you can have these models, but tier 2 and 3 city, definitely yes.
So this also calls for meeting of minds. You need to have people who think alike and, you know, force them to make this work. That will be an important criteria. But for those who find that difficult to you know, make it work, is asset light model an easier option to look at? Dr. Padwal, any take on that?
Yes, I think this kind of model we can definitely run properly. But as what sir said, we have tried this earlier in one of the hospitals, which was just a single specialty hospital. and the footfall was limited after some time. To increase that, what we started doing, we called upon the other specialties like ENT, like ophthalmic, even for that matter gynecology, and we started those OPDs in the afternoons. All those cardiac patients who were going in other hospitals for these kind of treatments started remaining in the same hospital, and the revenue increased, the work increased. So we had to create another OT for those patients, and the second OT was also running equally like how the CABG OT was running, cardiac OT was running. So this way I think we can think, but on these grounds one can, or the people can think.
Is asset light model an easier option, Amit?
I would say so. And see, asset light, you got to think about it from a couple of elements. One is land, right? That can I get into a rental long-term lease model with, you know, 15, 20, 30-year lease, vis-a-vis actually going out and purchasing, which is much, much more expensive. Nowadays, even in
Excuse
tier
me,
two.
Is he audible? So can we have a mic given
Hello.
To you with a label?
Oh. Better.
Yeah, so what I was saying is, you know, on the land end, you know, if you go for a rental model versus a acquisition model, I think it makes eminent sense because cost of real estate in India has gone through the roof, right? And
Absolutely.
We're talking about tier two markets, right? In America, in about a crore, you can buy something in the suburbs of San Francisco, right? Over here, in a crore, you're going to get nothing, right? Like maybe here in Nasik, you might get a small plot, you know, something, right? But in a tier one or something, forget about it, right? So if you go for a rental model where it's got a good appreciation, and typically the way to think about that is you should not pay more than 8 to 10% of the overall value of that land as a rental sort of stream. I think that makes a lot of sense. The second piece is that a lot of innovation has started coming through what we call implant models, which effectively means, and you know, slightly deviating
Hospital.
To what you were mentioning, doctor, but this is effectively, now we have guys who are doing, you know, oncology, right? We have guys who are doing particularly imaging, let's
say. So we'll come to that. Purely from an infrastructure perspective, we have now what is called real estate investment trusts. Does that make it any easier, Dr. Bhadunkar?
In fact, I don't know, the audience probably is aware of it. In USA, there is a law, in fact, which, in fact, in the 1960s, this thing started. The real estate was actually bought by the entrepreneur and rented back to the hospitals. So that is how the hospitals generated, you can call it cash flow. And they infused this money for running their day-to-day operations. That is how they started doing it. In the initial phases, there were some difficulties. They came to a stage where they actually evolved, and then they had to make a law to make it more how do you say, compliant with the law, in the sense compliant with the culture, with the social setup, with you know, the good things, you know, so that the bad things don't happen, non-ethical things. So that model is still yet to come in India, but again, you know, I had a little bit of experience. My earlier assignment was with a group which had five verticals, and one of them was real estate. So those guys, that vertical bought my hospital, and that money was put in for me as the operating part of my operating expenses. And that is how we started. So we experimented, we were doing quite okay. But as such, it is not picking up in India. Many of the real estate people, first of all, understand healthcare industry. So they don't want to put their money and then run a hospital. They say that, as you said, the symbiotic relationship, if that happens, probably this model may pick up. One of the big builders in Mumbai, if I remember, HDIL, his daughter is a doctor, and he is a builder. So he started this, but unfortunately, because of the recession in real estate, things are thoda thanda. But I think now people have realized that yes, real estate can be, because what happens is, the only thing is, going forward, we don't have an asset. So that way, but in the meanwhile, if you're asset light, you can make your, you can make your hospital PAT positive very fast. So that's,
so just to share, in our experience, we have found that a lot of real estate developers are looking to get into healthcare, just that they don't have the confidence to, you know, operate and manage the show. So which is why they look at partners who can probably manage the show and without which they're not willing to venture into it. So there is an interest, but you know, that relationship has to be forged before it can really take off. My next question, so we'll move from CAPEX to OPEX now. So what are the key financial indicators that you would track for your hospital?
My hospital is a trust hospital, and fortunately and unfortunately, I have worked in trust hospitals, trust meaning charitable hospitals, so-called charitable hospitals, and corporate hospitals. So I was lucky enough and not very lucky enough to work in both setups. When you work in a corporate hospital, you are fashioned to, or you're modeled, or you're structured in such a way that you start adopting the best practices, you work in a structured way, you go very professional, you have KRAs, you have SOPs, you look for accreditation, your staff is well trained, you have, you know, all those things fall in place. And your culture becomes different, and ekas laksha, people understand Marathi, is profit. So that is how it is. And the directors will allow you to work in a very professional way. And then you can give results, you can mold your hospital, you can mold your business, you can market any which way. The other side of the coin is a charitable hospital. Now, charitable hospitals have got a very old history. I come from a place in Mumbai where 99% of the hospitals are charitable hospitals. Charity into inverted commas. Trust registered under Mumbai, it's still not Mumbai, Bombay Charitable Trust Act 1950. So under that, you are supposed to be charitable. So you have to keep 20% of the beds for the poor and the indigent class. So they started with what, you know, once they are saying, "Yaar, bahut paisa ho gaya." For example, my hospital, 1932, was born in 1932. My grandfather also probably was not born. So, but anyway, that part of that period, once ATI will come and say, "Yaar, bahut paisa hai, kya karne ka? Hospital kholna hai." So similarly, everybody started, you know, that was the charitable way of looking at things. And then I would come and say, "Arey, Sethi ji, aapke isme sab to bana liya aapne, mere naam pe hospital ka aap ek operation theater de do, kitna doge? 2 crore, bana do." To operation theater ke bahar lag gaya. And the thing started picking up. But they didn't realize that you have to make surplus. So, and then how, this is the operating part of it. I mean, only charity
so
was in
the corporate hospitals, you voice it. In trust hospitals, you do not voice it. The bottom line and objective remaining the same.
Objective remaining. The only thing is whether you can really do it, because there are so many, there are constraints in a charitable hospital, whereas in a corporate hospital, you can actually do it in a...
So how do you benchmark the performance? What are the ratios you look at?
Now, for example, the usual things, you know, average length of stay and daily, you know, all those things are there. But in my hospital, when I took over, I realized that these are all good. They are tangible figures. What about the intangibles? Mm-hmm. The intangible thing is service. If you improve your service, you are definitely going to make a profit, irrespective of, you know, whether it's a XYZ type of hospital. So that is the first thing I did. I started, because what happens in these old hospitals, there are unionized staff members, and 90% of the guys are unionized, including the matron and the EDP guys and all. So you have to, you know, gel with them, develop a symbiotic relation with them. So that is what I started, and started giving them. They didn't know what budget was, they didn't know what is a KRA, they don't know what a protocol, standard operating process, pata nahi hai. So slowly. So instead of, you know, monitoring all this, I can give you a big list, you know. Some of them are very interesting. For example, which I you must be doing it, but, you know, just to share, because I found it very interesting when I went along. The usual things are there, average length of stay, daily galla kitna aapka aaya, padta kitna at the end of the day. I'm using Rajasthani language. That is all fine. But there is something very interesting, which some do, some don't do. OT prime time report. Morning hours is your prime time, afternoon not very prime, evening not very prime at all. OT utilization, but ye koi itna dekhta nahi hai. But then when you break down and then you see, then the results hit you. Casualty walk-ins, rota to the doctors. So walk-in versus rota. Rota in the sense, doctors kitne laate hai. And how many from them are admitted? People just see the conversion from OPD, but ye thoda alag ho jata hai. Then OPD consultants. OPD consultants, we look at, you know, the conversion, but then you also just go thoda andar ja ke dekho aap, investigations kitna laya, how many investigations they are bringing to the hospital, lot of money investigations, you know, all, radiology, imaging, lab, of course, and then you also see previous weeks, previous days, previous years. One thing I realized when I took over, discounts. And these discounts are for whom, you know, MLA, MP, corporator, politician, blah, 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 blah. So I put my foot down and said, sir, namaste, desh ki seva karni hai, toh sir, dusre jagah jaake kijiye. You know, as it is, we are giving 2% of the top line in charitable hospital for indigent. So there are many things which, you know, dikhta nahi hai on the surface.
I think it's very interesting, the metrics you bring out, against the conventional ones of the RPOB and the LOs that we talk of, because these are the ones that will actually add to the bottom line.
Right.
So
then I developed a, just 2 minutes more, sure. I developed a system where, you know, you have to look at quality. Quality is very important. We used to have quality meetings, we in the sense, my predecessors. Now what was a quality meeting? Isne ye complaint kiya, usne wo kiya, kya action liya apne, fir wo kiya, wo kiya, wo kiya. Sale ko notice de do. That was a quality meeting. I said, yeah, this is postmortem. You're not going to improve. So let's put some parameters in place. So I have put in a process system where we actually measure the parameters. Simple example, you got a phone call, within how much time the ambulance went from the hospital and when did it come back? Week on week, the quality officer has to present the data of similar nature. Waiting time in OPDs, how much time the physician to call the patient inside, how much time did he spend with the patient, and then what is the time that he came out. So and then we do it every week, so the time and day is fixed. Every Thursday 11 baje quality meeting, and then we started, instead of postmortem, actually seeing and, you know, measuring. So what we measure, we can improve, simple. So that's what we started. So I can go on, but you know, these are the few things which just a jhalak.
No, that's very interesting, sir, and I think hitting it, you know, where it needs to be. Coming to again metrics, this question is for Dr. Mahesh Padwal. Coming from a town which is not a metro currently that you're handling, what is the average revenue per operating bed expectation, and how do you tackle the problem of high cost of doctor recruitment combined with a relatively low tariff structure?
Well, what you're saying is absolutely right. It's very difficult to really meet the average revenue in a tier 2 town. In tier 2 town also, we have to present ourselves saying that we have this best and so many things. To show that, you have to really bring upon the actual person who can perform it. And these specialties or these bosses are in the tier 1 cities or in the metros. Now if I call upon somebody from metro, he will demand something more than what he is getting in metro from me. I have to give it to him and only then he will come. So I do call him in these terms. But then what we do is, we do not bear the losses, we really do not face the losses. We have started developing some other sides of it. Like earlier I said, that if I'm calling minimal access surgeon, which is not in Nasik, so he will come and operate, but we shall see to it that patient who has come for minimal access surgery, for his other problems like dentistry, ophthalmic, ENT, dermatology, he will not go to any other institute. He will remain in our institute.
So it's a spin-off that you leverage.
Yes. Secondly, we have concentrated upon the investigation part like pathology, radiology. We shall see to it that these patients do their investigations in our hospital itself, so that revenue we fetch. And very important is pharmacy. Pharmacy, we see to it that whatever kind of medication and things he needs, we make it available in our pharmacy. So from other sides, we see to it that this patient, or in terms of business clientele, remains in our campus, and he takes all other services from us, from where we take out the revenue which is being lost in paying the bigger people in the tier 1 cities.
My next question is to do with, we have the state-run insurance schemes, which have become bread and butter for a lot of organizations. Does it really help to build revenue, or is it a drain on the hospital?
Well, there could be the various opinions on this, but my personal opinion is it really helps.
It does.
It helps because what happens is, when the hospital becomes big, definitely your charges, your tariff becomes bigger. Now, for that, in tier 2 city, it is in X hospital, bahut mehenga hai. It is not for us. The small hospital is for me. There I can go, I can convince the doctor, and I can pay less, and I can take the same treatment what I shall be getting there. So I am using that particular thought process people. They will not come to me otherwise. But if I have such schemes, maybe it is insurance scheme, or maybe it is Rajiv Gandhi Yojana, or whatever like. If I have those schemes, that group also I can cater. They will come to me for one reason, but his 9 reasons I can treat in some other, or my actual tariff. If he comes for cardiology in Rajiv Gandhi Yojana, he will come. But he has done his angiography, he has done his angioplasty, he has done his CABG. But tomorrow I know he's going to have something like pneumonia, something like he's going to fall and have a fracture. He's going to have some dermatological.
So again, problem. It is a spin-off that you leverage.
Yes. So these schemes are helping me to earn over there. So they are not waste for me. They are really good for me. And in my tier 2 town, some small hospitals are really surviving on these kind of schemes.
The next, yeah.
I would just say not all schemes are created equal. You know, the major problem with these schemes is that the sort of accounts receivables, right? That sometimes you don't get paid for 6 months, 9 months. Now, if you can deal with that, then by all means do it. The other variable is obviously the tariff that they're giving you. CGHS sometimes gives you some pretty competitive rates. RSPI also, you know, if we look at South India and a lot of other states, the chief minister schemes and state level schemes, a lot of them are really good. But I would say that, you know, be careful, because the moment you get to more than 50% of these types of insurance schemes, there's private insurance separately, which is probably more lucrative.
That's a part.
Then you get into a situation where you're probably going to have to start borrowing money in order to be able to finance your working capital.
I can highlight this point with my practical experience. Whatever he's saying is the fact. MD India, very good organization, promised me, made my separate tariff from the yojanas. And believe me, like they were telling me, Andhra mein ye chalta hai, idhar ye chalta hai, why you are demanding so much? I said, see, if you are giving me this much, I'm ready to tie up with you, otherwise let's forget. So they did. They went according to my request and tariff. And in first 3 months, what you say, the same thing happened. I treated around 27 odd patients. And at the end of 3 months, I got the complete billing of only 4 patients. It was a bankruptcy kind of a thing. What I did, I got panicky. I took out my car, went to Bombay. I met the person over there, and I told him that you train me how to make the bill. You train me how to do. I sat there for 3 days. I learned everything. I came back. I trained my people. Actually, Rajiv Gandhi Yojana and all, they have their Jeevan Mitra or some Mitra in sitting in the hospital, Arogya Mitra in sitting in the hospital itself. You have to give him a desk right in front of the gate. I caught upon him. I said, come here, what you are doing? If you are not doing the billing properly, I'm not going to get the money. I have learned, now you do it the way I'm telling you. Believe me, the second month I got almost 60% of the bills, and third month onwards, 95% of the bills. 5% because we are staying in a kind of a atmosphere where there would be ye kyun nahi kiya, wo kyun nahi, and we are fighting with it. Secondly, BPL Yojanas, below poverty line Yojanas, I understood that something was going wrong. What I started doing, when I submitted my 40 files, I started going and sitting next to the deputy health director. Sir, chalo apun mera file check karenge. Ye kya hai, wo kya hai, ye barabar hai, this is for this I have given, this tent, yes, X tent I have used, which is approved by government, this is what I have done. And I started getting the bills approved from the deputy health director directly, and that really worked. My friend is here, Dr. Manoj is here, and Manoj would also agree with me, like with my hospital I used to take upon all other cardiologist bills also, and we taught them how to do that, how to approve it, and we started getting the good bills out.
So Dr. Bhadankar, I am told you have to pay for the recovery, so does it make sense?
I'll just make an observation. You all are a very enlightened audience. How many hospitals owned by politicians? I have worked in hospitals owned by politicians, not one, not two, quite a few. have this scheme? The answer is for you to find out.
All right, so we come to, you know, operational efficiency. So given your experience, would you like to share one example where you were able to cut cost in your setup that, you know, others can learn from?
Cutting cost, yeah. Now, for example, I can actually share a figure.
Cutting cost, not corners.
Yeah. Now, this is a very tricky thing. When you use the word cutting cost, you know, then the first thought that comes to your mind is, I'm going to sacrifice some service, or I'm going to reduce my service from there to this. So that's the first thing. And healthcare is labor intensive, capital intensive. Operations also, the costs are very high. So then it's really a circus that you have to perform. Literally, you have to balance. And but for an able administrator, the best part is to actually relook at your operating costs and dissect them. When you dissect them, you realize that many of the costs may not be productive costs. They are costs, but they are not productive vis-a-vis your top line.
So for example that has stayed with you, something that you did.
Yeah, for example, now when I took over this charitable hospital where I'm now working, the first thing that hit me is manpower cost. So I was wondering, everybody knows that when a hospital is new, the manpower cost in terms of top line is always high. But when you go along, as your operations increase or efficiency increases, the manpower cost automatically comes down and you're to the top line, and then you come to a standard figure, all India figure, where it is a good hospital is 12-13%, little better hospital is 15-18%. My hospital, when I took over, I have the figure with me. I'll just share. I'll not give the actual figures, but in terms of percentage, I'll share. From 27% in 15-16 to 24% in 9 months, when I have taken, I'm just 9 months old in this system. How did I do it? First of all, when I started looking, there were people who were without affecting service. There were people,
and in an environment which is unionized.
Which is unionized. For example, now there are a lot of things which can be actually outsourced, and you all know the standard ones: the laundry, the linen, the food services, security. Housekeeping, these are all the standard ones. Engineering. I realized that, you know, people on board, because what happens, trustees generally are non-medical guys, and then they will say, sir, hospital loss mein ja raha hai, kya karna chahiye? First thought is what? Aadmi kam karo. So when I came, first day I landed, there was a morcha of Shiv Sena. I said, kya ho raha hai? Aadmi, 56 aadmi ko kam kar diya. And then I was wondering, why 56 aadmi, why all of a sudden? So I said, sir, aisa dekhte nahi, we have to look at the bigger picture. You have reduced the army, but you have kept all the generals. And the generals are, you know, one general, one task, four generals are doing the same thing, and different signals going to the management. So what I did, I actually, you know, divided the work, actually started with JDs, literally, and KRAs. And then we gave them their, and we actually linked the productivity to their number of hours and all, and then aapka kaam ye bhaiya, ye aapka kaam hai, ye aapka kaam hai, ye aapka kaam hai. This is how we have to do it.
Rationalize manpower and which contributors,
yes.
Which is an important
without you know. So it does happen. And then quality is very important. I would say training and development leads to quality.
So
training and development is very important, which people, we generally don't do it. We think it's a cost. It's not a cost. It's definitely an investment, and it will help you save cost. It doesn't look tangible in the beginning, but you do it and you see the results.
So
you please try it. It's a fantastic tool that we administrators never use it.
So
we just
it
do for
do
the heck of doing it.
Was it more to do with outsourced services where you applied the CHOP?
No, I'm just giving examples. You know, for example, a simple thing like we have to give medical records. That it's a right of the patient to ask for it. So the obvious thing is Xerox nikal ke de do, right? And in a busy hospital, Xerox means it's a factory. When I rationalize the whole thing, there are five Xerox operators and five Xerox machines and paper cost and cartridge cost and this cost and that cost. Now I've got two machines and no efficiency has not been cut.
I can quite imagine there's a hospital we are doing which is a 250-bed hospital where we were to reorganize the lab. Currently they are operating out of 10,000 square feet and in the new environment they are getting about 3,000 square feet, which is actually enough to put up a lab. But the only reason why it was difficult to do so was they had 60 technicians which they could not have laid off. So that says a lot.
I have something to say about this. When you start a hospital and when it is new, you need to have more staff than required to give good services so that you can attract more and more patients. This scenario should be changed after a year or two. Why? Because then your people get trained and they can perform the same work in a better way and in a faster way. So I feel that the overhead cost should be controlled. Now, when I look at it, say maybe for first year, if I have say 5 nurses working for 10 patients, because it is a beginning, after 2 years, you should divide those 5 nurses for your newly developed department, send 3 of them over there, let 2 be here, and let them control that ward. I mean, we have to do it rationally. We have to understand the proportion required. But this way, we can definitely think of utilizing the overheads in a proper way so that it will bring down the cost automatically. Secondly, initial phase, we really do not see that patient demands, mere ko ye khana hai. Yes, he gets that. Then he demands, I want a soup also. Yeah, he gets soup. So it goes on for a year or so. In that, if we have to see what we are wasting. You know, at the end of the day, we almost waste 50% of these food and beverages. If we weigh them, we understand that we have been in loss. If we would have saved it for tomorrow.
So you dissect each head of expense to see where the waste lies and eliminate the waste.
Yes.
Got it.
So thirdly, like initial phase, somebody comes at 1 o'clock in the afternoon or 8 o'clock in the morning and says, the doctor has sent me for USG abdomen. Okay, chalo iska USG abdomen karo. Kitne baje aaya? 9 o'clock. Do it. No, we should rationalize. We should see. The OPD patients should be done in the afternoon and in the evenings. They can come in the afternoon and evening. But IPD patients who have to undergo some procedures at 9 o'clock, they should be done at 8 o'clock. Their USG should be done. So this way we have to adjust everything and that will definitely fetch good business. See, your one USG machine will be used for various patients at various timings. So that one overhead is catering to so many people, giving you the output of earning. So this, I think, should be seen. Another important thing is what claims we do, mediclaims. This is a service also to the patient as well as our earning. Sometimes our people fill up the form in a wrong way and they just submit it and there is a decline from the medical, I mean this insurance company, they say we decline your request and that's
all. It takes longer to close the process.
No, then the patient and relatives come for discount. Tumhare hospital mein aaya insurance tha karke, abhi nahi insurance mil raha, give me discount, you are at loss. This department, if you develop properly and if you see to it that all the forms and papers are filled properly, if you are able to reduce the decline.
Again,
cases,
eliminate wasteful processes,
yes,
do it right the first time.
Yes.
Before we wrap up, a quick question, I mean, for those of you wanting to get into healthcare or starting a new venture, bottom lines get reflected initially when you do the financials and you talk in terms of break-even point, internal rate of return. So this question goes to Amit. We speak of break-even point in when we do the projections. We do these projections over not 5 years, but even 7 years, 10 years, by which time typically you would have done an additional capital infusion. So this notion of seeing a BEP as a number, what is the sanctity of that number?
So there's a couple of ways to think about break-even point. One is the operational break-even, which means when you become cash flow positive, which is basically you take your revenue, you subtract your operating cost structure, and you come up with your EBITDA. Right, so whenever you get into that EBITDA positive range, now actually I just want to address the tier 2 audience also here. I mean, Nagpur is a pretty advanced tier 2 market, but sir mentioned, in tier 1 cities you might see that break even very, very optimistically in 3 years, otherwise in about 4 years or so where you're getting cash flow positives. In tier 2 cities, definitively, and I'm working in this particular market, in fact I'm traveling probably 40% of the 100 tier 2s and tier 3s in India this year itself, so I have a good sense of this market. Half the billing about half the cost structure as well. So we're talking about hospitals that become positive in operational profit by year two, and that's a norm. It's not a, you know, an outstanding component. So you all should be very proud of that, because you know, yeah, you are much more profitable than your peers in Mumbai and Delhi, or have the potential to be, right? You know, the second piece is obviously your capital payback, right? At what point in time am I going to actually pay off my entire asset, and can I make off all the money that I put into the capital of this business? And typically in a larger tier one market, it's like 8 years, 9 years, as Sir also mentioned. Over here, it could be 6 to 7 years, right? So you got to think about it from those respects. And you know, just actually just getting back really quickly to the earlier question that was there, because I just wanted to kind of mention one or two points. The implant component, now with all these single specialty players out there, you have, you know, ICU implants, you know, people can come and bring ICUs and set them up in your hospitals. You have guys who will come and pump in a LINAC for you. They'll bring, you know, dialysis machines to you. They'll do everything, right? All you need to do is give them the real estate. They'll bring the operators, everyone, right? And you just have to figure out what is the break-even point on which my sort of revenue share with this guy covers not just my rent, but the sort of profit expectation that I have. And I really think, not just in, you know, low-end areas like ophthal, but you do it even in, you know, radiotherapy, for instance, right? You can have, you know, that Manavyanta Curie Center that we worked with in Nashik, right? I mean, fantastic job that they're doing. Second piece is the optimal marketing. I'm sorry, I'm getting to the previous question. You know, the one marketing that we are all very aware of is the cut practice and referrals. Now, sometimes doctors end up taking 20% of your overall billing, you know, including pharmacy and investigations. Number one, you need to know how to actually negotiate on that and not include pharmacy and pathology into that. Otherwise, matlab aap nangai ho jaoge. Ya to fir aapko basically, you have to also understand that, you know, on that particular model, you know, you want to be very optimal in terms of how you're getting marketing. So I don't think referrals is the most optimal way to get marketing. How else can you improve your OP to IP conversion? What else can you do externally in order to get patients? And sure, if you're more efficient in that, you'll be more profitable.
Sure, thanks. We're open to questions. You can leverage these resources that we have here, and if you have any questions to put forth. Yes, sir. One moment, sir, he's getting the mic.
Yeah, while establishing a hospital, you said one of the module is lease rent model, where you, if you give 8 to 10% of the lease, it's a fair enough lease. But then if you see the current scenario, you get lap at the rate of 9 to 10%. So why not to buy a property, and the same property can be used as a that can be your asset of that for that hospital, and so then same property can be used as a lab.
You're absolutely right. I'm actually referring to the benchmark that was set up by Fortis in the real estate investment trust model that they had put in place via Singapore, coming in, putting 100 crores, buying out the asset, and then taking that amount from them. Now they actually took the profit also. They took the revenue share. So in the end of the day, that's why the Fortis price never moved. It was all the profit was going to Singapore. But you know what I'm mentioning is, yes, 8-9% is still very high, but come up in such a way that over the lease period, you know, I am not kind of off the bat in 4-5 years paying off that entire amount, that it's a little bit longer term. And see, the benefit to leasing is, you know, the capital upfront today versus the capital that you're spending over 10 years, right? There's a big difference in that, you know, the opportunity cost on that capital, then, you know, your ability to kind of even make interest on that. Jaise aapka agar aaj 100 crore hai, hai na, and aap usko land property mein nahi dal rahe ho, 10 saal ke andar aap usko, you know, FD mein bhi dal rahe ho, to aapko uska annuity bhi mil raha na. So I'm saying it from kind of that perspective, and I wouldn't say a rule of thumb as in, you know, 8-10% or so. Obviously, you'd want to go for something slightly smaller, but, you know, over a longer term, it might be easier to manage that sort of cash flow, because if you're taking up debt just to buy that land, fir aap operations mein kya karoge? Fir aapko further debt bhi nahi milega operations mein dalne ke liye ya equipment khareedne ke liye.
Point taken.
I would just add to Amit's point. Sir, the amount which remains as a surplus with you by taking the partner or leasing it out, that amount remains with you. Instead of putting it into that department, you can put it into the department which is a cash cow, and you can start earning from there. From the same amount, you can start earning good profits, and let this particular part be leased out and that can be run by somebody else. I've seen the hospitals where these things are leased out, like artificial kidney department or cath lab or oncology. They have only one small department to see. So they take it to a very good level and they deliver wonderful services. Even sir would agree with me. So automatically what happens, you have oncology given, you have artificial kidney department given, you have pathology given. So for accreditation and all other purposes, you can show them your success departments, and that adds into your more points. And that money can be that can be used for the capex in your cash cow.
Thank you, sir. A round of applause for our panelists.
One more question. What is the average project cost for multi-speciality hospital in a tier 2 city per bed cost?
Maybe I'll just take a quick stab at that. So in a tier 1 city, you can spend anywhere from 75 lakhs to 1 crore per bed for a multi-speciality hospital. In a tier 2 city, that's probably within the 50 to 75 lakh range. 75 lakhs would be a very, very high-end sort of facility. And on just capex, right, if you're talking about not including, all your cost towards commissioning, etc., and if you're just talking about, let's say, equipment or something, then that would be about half of that amount, 25 lakhs or something like that, yeah.
Thank you, Amit. We now have to, we look forward to listening to Dr. Girdha Gyani.